few couple of people Friday off. So going to start 10 minutes early. So we'll be start 1:15. Starting next Monday, starting next Monday. I'm going to send an email to everyone to remind everyone we're going to start 1:15.
I don't know that day.
The document on Blackboard?
No, it cannot be loaded on Blackboard. You can go to the YouTube, and then you can go to the library. No, yeah. Library has a copy. Okay, I'm going to say it one more time and writing it down, okay? It's called Commanding Heights.
Commanding Heights.
Episode 1, The Battle of the Ideas. Writing this down? Yes, John. I'm asking you.
I was zoned out.
There are a couple questions come from there. If you miss this couple questions, these certain points will be missed by you. All right, so today, and we're going to start moving to chapter 3, okay? Chapter 3 talks about the market and the supply and the demand, okay? And I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the concept because concept is very straightforward, and I want to finish talking about concept by Wednesday. Then starting next week, we're going to do a lot more attention and analyze all kinds of affairs. You supply the demand. Okay. All right. So we're going to divide the market. So from this chapter, we're going to start talking about market. There are different kinds of market. Okay. But we're going to start with what we call the perfect competitive market. There are following characteristics for the perfect competitive market. First one, there must be many providers or sellers in the market. There must be many providers or sellers in this market. Okay. That's characteristics one. Okay. And the second one, and it talks about the product. The products are identical. You have a question?
What chapter is this from?
Chapter 3. But, you know, perfect competitive market, that concept is not in the book. So that's why you need to take notes. Okay. So the first characteristic, there must be many sellers or providers. The second one talks about the products. Products must be exactly identical. So the products provided by the different providers, perfect competitive market.
What does that say on top? Market? It just says market.
It's just a market. Okay. So the second characteristic there says the product provided by the different providers must be exactly identical. Okay. And the third characteristics, there must be no barrier to enter or exit the market. There is no obstacle or barrier to enter or exit.
What is the second characteristic?
The products provided by different providers are identical. And there is no difference whatsoever. I got it?
Can you repeat number one?
Number one says there must be many providers or sellers in the market. So last one. Each firm is a price taker. Each firm, each provider is a price taker, not a price setter. And you will see in a minute, price taker. They take the price determined by the market. They have to sell the goods at that price. That's the meaning, that's the what means by price taker. And the very last one. Okay, so wait, how many we have?
Four so far.
Last one. Go with this market power. Market power. Not heard of this word, market power. What? No, nobody has heard of this word. We often say, okay, this firm has a lot of market power, or this firm does not have much market power. What do we mean by that?
Not in control of the market.
That means, okay, now I'm going to tell you the definition of market power. Market power is the power of charging a higher price than everybody else, but not losing all the customers. If the firm is able to do that, then we say they have some market power. Market power is the power of charging a higher price without losing all the customers.
Thank you.
Some of you are now taking notes, and I want to tell you this is not in the book, but maybe in the quiz or in the exam. Okay? So I do encourage you to
give an example of market power.
Chick-fil-A.
Okay, good. What do you think about Starbucks here? Starbucks.
They're very expensive, but they don't lose their best.
What is
Mac Pack?
Right? Was that the stuff good?
Yeah,
they
stuff good.
Appreciate it.
That's true. The stuff is pretty good. But what you will have for three other Starbucks, do you think they're going to still have this much sale?
I see.
Oh yeah, there's another one. That's true. That's true.
They don't give out people else.
You know, in the past, I think it's 6-7 years ago, we did have a really nice coffee shop in that street, for the kind of main street, you know, across the, you know, there was, and that was a very nice one, actually, but because it's off campus, a little bit less convenient compared to this one, so we went to move out of the business. Okay. So location, the product, everything can contribute to what we call this market power.
So number five is that they have market power, or that
they don't have market power. No firm in this market has any market power. Okay, so this market here. Okay, I may ask you. Okay, so in the quiz. Okay, or exam. Okay, I'm going to give you. I may put a multiple choice question on this. Okay. So if you look at that, so look at those five characteristics. What's the impression you get?
It's the same company.
Variety.
What do you think about this market, the nature of this market? Oh, can you find a market that is perfect in competitive market very easily?
Android?
No.
No, right? Heard a lot of no's. Right, because this market is in stream. It's in stream. Why stream? Can you find any element in this market that will maintain certain kind of higher price or certain kind of profit for this firm in this market?
If a company enters into this kind of market, then they don't stand to make a lot of money.
They don't. First, they have many competitors. That's the first characteristic, right?
Right.
The the second one, and everybody is producing exactly the same product, right? So there's no differentiation. You cannot say my product is better than yours because everybody else is producing exactly the same thing, right? And the third one, entering and exiting is easy. There's no barrier. So if you're making huge profit and other firms from outside this bank see it and they're going to enter in, they're going to start sharing the profit with you. Okay, the last one, you know, the price takers will take the price, you know, determined by the market and how to sell the good at the price. So every characteristic here and support this claim that, you know, there's very few opportunity for the firm in this market to make profit or sustain a positive profit. So this market here is extreme, okay, it's extreme. And it's very hard to find an example, find a market that is almost perfectly competitive, okay? And the example we use is agricultural goods, okay, like potatoes. Okay, for those kind of things.
Oh, yeah, like bananas, like they all, like, what is in mind, like 59 cents.
Yeah, for the agricultural goods, if you think about that market, and we can see that market is very close to that one. Okay, first thing, okay, let's check for each category. First one, there's many providers and sellers. There's many, many farmers, right? And within the country that produce potatoes, right? The second one, the goods are exactly identical. We do know that potatoes probably have some difference in where it come from, but you know, for me, most of consumers, they probably do not care too much about where the potato come from, right? Okay, so second one, third one, there's no barrier to entry and exit. And some farmer decide to grow potato this year, and they can grow potato, and next year they can leave this market and grow something else, right? There's no barrier to enter exit. And each firm, each provider is a price setter, no, is a price taker. No farmers have any control with the price of when they sell it. Market determine the price, and they have to take that price and they sell it at the price. Okay, so agricultural goods market is very similar to perfect competitive. Okay, let me ask you about another market, and you all have cell phone here. What do you think about cell phone market?
No.
Definitely not. Tell me which characteristic is not met.
Is it a proprietor?
It's not identical, right? The second one is, how about the rest of the characteristics?
You don't get the same prices. You don't get the same prices.
Okay. So they are?
Some are a price setter. Some are a price setter.
Some of them, that's right.
Okay. But they do have market power.
So they do have market power, that's right. Whenever it's not perfect competitive, but there is not perfect competitive, that means there's a market problem in that market.
Okay. Say that again.
When there is,
when there's no market power, you're not a
market. When there is no market power, and when
there's no competitors, there's no market power. There is market power, I'm sorry. That's what it is. She said that when there is no competitor, there's market power. That's what she said.
As long as there is competition there, as long as there's perfect competition, we don't have market power. If we have any little bit market power, the market is not perfect competitive. Cell phone market is not. And what else here?
So what else isn't a...
Car market. Car market, that's right. Okay, auto market is not.
Which university you go to?
Okay, so education market. So you talk about education, who is a provider for the education, okay?
Food, restaurants,
that depends on what kind of restaurant you're talking about. Yeah.
I'm saying like all of them, not just like a certain one. McDonald's even have different prices too. And then the little Burger King's, because I remember there was this one at the transit, like the little apple pie was $1, and somewhere else it was like $1.49.
Yeah, we're going to talk more about different market structure. Yeah, but yeah, you're right, it's not perfect competitive. Yeah, but for some restaurant market, it's competitive, but just not perfect. Any other questions here related to this? So this is the market we're gonna focus on for now. For the, this is the month. For the next whole month, we're gonna focus on this market. Then we're going to move on to a market with some market powers. All right. Okay, so understanding this, the market we're talking about. So next thing we want to determine is this. I want to answer this question. Okay. What should be produced?
For it to be a perfect market? For it to be a perfect market?
Yeah. So for any kind of market, we ask this question. What should we produce in this market? Okay, okay. What should we provide to consumers?
It depends on their wants and their needs.
That's right. And then the next question is, who gets what's produced? So if the first question deals with the product, okay? And the second question deals with the consumers who are going to get the product, okay? And the third question is, how is it produced? So this deal with the production and deal with the technology. Okay. So in those three questions, actually, and we have producer theory, consumer theory, and market equilibrium embedded in those kind of questions. So we're going to answer those questions as we move along in this course. Okay. So, and today and this week, what we're going to do is not target, you know, any individual question here, but we're going to target an element that will contribute to answering those questions. One of the characteristics I mentioned here is price taker. Each firm here takes a price and they have to sell the good at that price. So we start with here, okay? Then if they are the, not the one that are going to determine the price, then who determines price? Market. So today we're going to talk about supply and demand model. By using this demand, supply and demand model, we're able to answer this question, how the price is determined. For supply-demand model, there's two aspects. Demand side and the supply side. When you go to a grocery store, you buy a box of cereal, costs you $3.50. In that price, some cereal is that expensive, $3.50.
Oh no, that's cheap.
That's cheap.
Wait, is it the family size or is it the
I don't know. I just made up that price. No. In that price, there is demand and there is supply. So what we want to do here by using this model is to dissect this price. See how this $3.50 is determined by using this supply and demand model. Okay? So we're going to analyzing this the market by divide in by dividing, you know, everything into two sides. One is supply and one is demand. And when we talk about the demand, we do not care about the supply at all. So keep this in mind. when we talk about the demand side, we don't care about the supply side. When we talk about supply side, and we don't care about demand side. And later on, after we understanding both sides, and we're gonna put them together and use that to understand where's that $3.50 come from, how that $3.50 is determined. Okay, so this is the methodology we use. We have to start with one side and then move on to the next side. Okay, so now we're gonna start with the demand side. Demand side deal with consumers' preference, consumers' willingness to pay. Okay, it's a question about, okay, what do you want to consume? Okay, and how much you want to pay? And deal with this kind of things, right? All right, so we start with the demand. I'm going to introduce you what we call the demand line or demand curve. Okay. So now I have this graph here. Along the vertical axis, here represent the price. And this represents the quantity. Okay. And this is not the quantity at equilibrium, and this is not the quantity that consumer eventually consume in this market, okay? It is a variable here. And we say demand line or demand curve looks like this. Okay. Have you guys seen this graph before?
Yes.
Good. Okay, can you tell me what this graph tells you?
Demand. Wait, the more you make, the less the demand is?
If you have a large amount of something, then you can price it very low because you got to get rid of it. But the more scarce an object is, the more valuable it is. So the
price. Okay. I want to emphasize one more time, we're in the demand side. We care about consumers' willingness. And we care about consumers. How many products, how many quantities they would like to buy. We are concerned about those things. The consumer cannot set the price. Can you, when you go to the supermarket, you can, right? But you look at this book, look at this cell phone, you say, okay, $350. You determine whether I want to accept this price or not, right? So that's what we deal with, and that's what we care about when we talk about demand side. The willingness to pay, and how much do you want to buy. Okay, so based on what I just said, and tell me, what does this curve, how do we explain this curve, how do we interpret it, this curve here?
How much you're willing to buy at a price?
At each given price, how many products you're willing to consume? What is the quantity demanded? Okay, so that's what demand curve is. It tells you at each given price, and what is the quantity demanded by each individual, if this is the individual demand. If this is the individual demand. Okay? So, negative or positive slope?
Negative.
Okay, so what does it mean?
Slopes downward.
So what does it mean? How do we interpret it? The negative slope.
The lower the price, more the more we buy.
The lower the price, and the higher the quantity demand, right? And we call this the law of demand. Law of demand. Law of demand tells you the higher the price, and the lower the quantity demand. So, just by looking at this graph here, and you know, the price is going to affect the quantity demanded, right? But do you think this is the only factor that's going to affect consumers' consumption on something?
No.
What are the things that might affect you how much you want to buy?
Quality.
Okay, quality, good, okay.
Or Are there anything you need it?
Whether or not you need it, preference?
Preference?
No, I mean like food versus a new laptop.
Mm-hmm.
Like actual needs.
We can put into the category of preference.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah. We prefer food than laptop, right?
It depends on what you're doing.
Okay, again, the preference, right?
The disposable income.
Income, right? Very important factor, income. So there's another factor here. That's going to affect at what price you're willing to accept this. Okay, and that also affect how many you would like to buy at this price. Your preference. Somebody's willing to pay, you know, $1,000 for iPhone 7. Somebody's willing to pay $500 for iPhone 7. Different preference. Okay, what else? Very good. Income and the preference, what else? That's gonna affect the quantity being needed.
Age, does that fall in preference?
Mm-hmm. That's right. That's very good. Very good. You start thinking critically now. Okay. Structurally.
Just demographics, period.
Demographics, again, fall into the preference. Different demographics have different kind of preference. Mm-hmm.
The consumer's location.
Consumer's location. Explain to us.
Sorry?
Explain.
If you were in an area that didn't have Wi-Fi, wouldn't be very obliged to buy a computer.
Oh, so you think it's okay, it's a location or it's something else? So you have to have a Wi-Fi in order to use this device, right? So Wi-Fi and the device has to be used together. So your consumption of one good actually depends on the availability of another product, the Wi-Fi.
So,
what is that? What about like just your location? Like there wouldn't be a big market for snowblowers down in the Nevada desert, but in Alaska there would be because the market is up there.
Yes, but what you're talking about actually is different from what he's talking about. He's talking about two markets that's related. Two goods that is related.
That's not a substitution.
So let's just focus on the one more to yours, okay? So in his example, he said you have to have Wi-Fi to use this device. If there's no Wi-Fi, then you cannot use this device, right? Basically, that's the idea here. So I'm going to summarize that as the price of related goods. Okay, I'll explain to you. Related goods, it's going to have a big impact on the quantity demanded for any product. Okay, so here you talk about the Wi-Fi and the device. I'm going to give you another example here. Going to movie theater, you know, we probably know the parking is free for the most movie theater, right? Parking is free. But what if some parking is not free? Charge you, let's say, $2. For 3 hours. That's going to affect your decision whether you're going to watch a movie there or not, right?
Yeah.
So you may think this is the location, but what is rule is you got to consume parking and the movie together, right? You have to consume. So we treat this as a product. We treat this, you know, the parking as like a product, a service we have to consume while we watch the movie, while we consume this movie as well. So when you have to consume two goods simultaneously, then one good's price, and it's going to affect the quantity demanded in the other building. So whether the parking is free or not, whether that is free or not, it's going to affect whether you want to watch the movie in that building. Same idea. So we call these two goods here, parking and the movies, or the Wi-Fi and the device, we call their complements. Complements are the goods that we have to consume together. We cannot consume separately. Another example would be if you buy a Mac computer, you have to buy certain software to go with it, right? You cannot buy different. So these two goods, we call them complements. If the software that designed for Mac are more expensive, and that's going to affect your decision whether you want to buy Mac or not. You guys follow me on that?
Mm-hmm.
So that's one kind of relationship we want to talk about. Complements. Now I want you guys to give me another example of two goods that are complements, which means you have to consume them simultaneously.
So a phone and a charger.
Phone and a charger, good. Okay.
Peanut butter and jelly.
Okay. Even though I can consume them separately. Okay, for some people they are complements, right? Okay, it varies from an individual to another individual. Others?
Car and gas,
that's right. That's right. That's why the gas price is going to affect your consumption on the electronic car or, you know, hybrid or gas car.
I was going to say wireless headphones and iPhone 7s.
Wireless?
Wireless headphones, iPhone 7s.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
A book and an access code.
Well, let me think about this one.
The book on.
You have to consume both. Together?
Even if you buy it online, you're still buying the book.
Hmm?
Even if you're buying like your code online, you're still buying a version of the book.
But you can buy the book without access code.
Either way, you gotta have a book.
All right. That's an interesting example. On the surface, appear to be complement because we do have to consume, for this class, you have to buy them together. However, you don't have the choice. You know, what I mean by that is, if you sign up for the class, and this class required that, and you have to buy them, you know, buy both, or either one, you have to buy them. So you really do not have a choice of not buying them. So you don't have that choice, okay? When we talk about this complement, relationship of these two goods, actually, and we're assuming that, you know, each individual has a choice, okay? I think this software is too expensive, then I decide not to go with Mac. So you have that individual choice, but in this incident, you really don't. You have to buy. So it's slightly different, but it's a very good choice. Others? Complements. So when we have a good that is complement to another good, then one good's price is going to affect another good. Okay. That's one kind of relationship we want to talk about. There's another kind of relationship that's also very important.
Substitutions.
Substitutions. Give us an example.
Like, 1%, 2% milk. Does that work?
Good try. Go ahead.
Or you could have like another brand of ketchup, like you got Heinz.
Uh huh. Okay. Yes. Okay.
You don't need.
Just use something. For example, Pepsi and Coke. Is there anybody that prefer one or the other? Probably some. A lot of people do, right? I prefer Pepsi. But you know, if you really need something, you probably can substitute one or another. So let's assume, you know, Coke and Pepsi are perfect substitutes. You have no preference, you know, and for one over the other one. Then when Coke's price goes up, what's going to happen to the quantity demanded on Pepsi?
It's
going to
go up.
Let me repeat. Okay. If Coke's price goes up, what's going to happen to the quantity demanded on Pepsi?
It's
going to go up, right? Okay, so I'm going to buy a relatively cheaper good. Okay.
But with Coke, you get the Coke reward.
I'll make our model more complicated. Okay, So this is another very important factor that's going to affect the quantity demand. It's related goods. If there's a related good and the price of that related good changes, and it's going to affect your quantity demand on this particular good. What else? So far we talked about the three different factors: income, price of related good, preference. All this going to affect the quantity demanded. Are there other factors?
Yes.
Good answer. There are millions of other factors that will affect the quantity demand. For example, I'm sick of this drink. I just decide to quit, you know? I know there will be a sale going on that next month, okay, because of the holiday. And I'm going to wait until then to buy this product, okay? So that's what we call dispensation. Yeah, so there's many more other factors that's going to affect the quantity demand. So we don't have space or time at least all of them. Okay. Now let me ask you this. So we have a... I'm going to move this. So we have a problem here, or issue here. There are so many factors that affect the quantity demand. Why? In this graph, you only have a price there. So how do we accommodate all of those by using this graph?
Isn't it depending on how much the business can make, with the money they got?
Okay, remember, we're on the demand side. We don't care about the producer. We don't care about the firm that providers.
Those factors affect whether the graph moves left or right.
That's right. So on the surface, it looks like those factors are not in here. But it's not true. Those factors are in this. Okay? All those factors determine the location and the shape of this demand curve. Any one of those factor changes, the location and the shape of this demand is going to move. It's going to change. So on the surface, this graph here is just price and quantity, but it's not true. All of those are in here. It determines the look, the shape, and the location of this thing. Okay. When those things are held constant, when those things are fixed, then this demand curve is determined and remains at this position. Okay, you guys with me here? Okay, let me ask you this. Income increases. How this demand is going to change? How this going to shift?
You're more willing to buy now.
Some people say go up, and you say going to go to the right.
So, if your income goes up, you're more willing to buy.
I'll tell you a counter example. Okay. When I was a graduate student at Chapel Hill, I seldom went to shopping for clothes. Okay. And the place I would shop is the TJ Maxx because those are discounted price. So even though I didn't have much money, but I shopped there a lot. Okay. Once I graduated, got a university job, and then we went to TJ Maxx. Oh, I went to TJ Maxx very only twice to 3 times a year. So my consumption in that store, when my income has increased. So does this happen to you? Well, I do. But also I
but
know
you got
that.
Whole money.
Yeah, but there's more money to save.
But she can buy Versace.
Even though it sounds funny, but it's right. When you have more income, your preference change. Mm-hmm. What you're willing to buy is gonna change. Right now you may be settled with a Camry. But when you have $200,000, you want to have a bundle work, you know? Your preference will change when you compete. But go back to that example. I go to TJ Maxx less often now. My consumption of the goods there has been decreased, but my income has increased.
But you're buying somewhere else now.
So what is that? What is that? But I know for some
the
other goods.
Change.
So what is that? Can someone give me insight on what kind of?
Would that be a preference?
Let's do. Belong to the category of income. But for some other goods, my consumption has gone. I went to the shopping mall, go to the regular clothing store mall. So here we talk about what?
Trade-off.
Two different kind of goods. So economists divide the whole good into two categories. One category, I call them, I know, just to be funny, crap.
Crap.
Inferior goods.
So crap.
Shit.
Crap.
I mean, even though the goods are pretty good a lot of times.
So there's two different kind of goods, actually, we're dealing with, or anyone is dealing with. Inferior goods or normal goods. For some people, this may be inferior, but for other people, it may be normal goods, right? When you have more income, your consumption on inferior goods to decrease. But for the normal goods consumption, it's going to go up. So that's the difference. So whenever we talk about the impact of income on on this mean, you have to know whether we talk about inferior goods or the normal goods. So if we talk about the normal goods, how this demand is going to shift? You have a question?
Nope.
So I asked the question already?
No, I was going to ask one, but...
Okay, so how the demand is going to shift? If it's normal good and income has increased?
Demand's going to go up.
Demand is going to go up? And where is it going to shift?
The right.
Going to shift this way. And if it's inferior good, demand is going to go down, it's going to shift this way. So that's the impact of income. So you have to know what kind of goods we're dealing with. What kind of goods, you know, this month.
Would you say that in most cases, income is the most important determining factor?
It is, yes. So now let's talk about price of related goods. Price, quantity, okay. Now I'm going to use Coke and Pepsi. Simple example, okay? And this represents Coke's market. Now I'm telling you the Pepsi's price goes down. How the demand for Coke is going to change? Coke is good. The quantity demand for Coke is going to go down, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, if it goes down, where is it going to shift? So when two goods are substitutes, well, one goods price goes down and the other goods quantity demand is going to go down. When one goods price goes up, the other goods quantity demand is going to go up. So they change in the same direction. Okay. Where is it? All right. Let's see. Example from the book.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Can we add RC to that? The Coke and Pepsi. The Royal Crown.
Can we what?
Little RCs.
What?
RC Cola.
It's a knockoff of Pepsi and Coke or whatever.
It's a...
Doesn't even exist.
Well, we want it to be simple. Yeah, we want to be simple. Yeah, we just want to see the relationship related. Good. You know, we don't want any, you know, other, you know, factors. Okay. Okay. So, bacon and eggs. Are they compliments? For some people, they are. Let's assume they're compliments. Okay. If this represent, okay, eggs, okay, your consumption of egg. Okay. So now you have a question.
Yeah. Why didn't it go to the left if Pepsi's price went down?
When Pepsi's price gone down, you know, Coke's quantity demand is going to go down, so it goes to left. So why? You ask why it goes to left?
Or yeah, if Pepsi's price decrease, doesn't the demand for Coke go up?
No.
I mean, go, okay. Never mind.
Right.
Yeah, I got it.
Got it. Yeah.
So
okay. So this represents your individual demand for egg. Okay, in that particular restaurant. Okay, so you went to this restaurant and tell them, okay, today we run out of bacon. How that's going to affect your demand for eggs? It's going to go down. Okay, so when you have two goods that complement, and when one good is not available, okay, and it's going to affect demand. Now, what if they say, okay, we have bacon. But now we charge, you know, $2 per bacon. Okay. Before it's $1.50, now it's $2. Okay, so that's how that's going to affect your demand for eggs.
It's going to go down.
Okay, so when the bacon price goes up, the quantity demanded and for eggs, it's going to go down, right?
And that's because they're complements. Well, to some people, you said they're complements.
Complements, okay. Yes. So for two, when two goods are complement, when one good price goes up, the other good's quantity then is going to go down, opposite direction. But if two goods are substitutes, then one good price goes up, the other good quantity then goes up, the same direction. Okay. Okay. And we're going to stop here. Going to continue this stuff, you know, on Wednesday.
How many?
5 to 7. Oh, sorry. But there's no quiz online. Don't worry about it.